Hello, my name is Jim Heath. I'm the president of the Institute for Systems Biology, and I'm here this morning with Dr. Noa Rappaport and Dr. Kengo Watanabe. And they have a paper coming out in Nature Medicine on a topic which I think many people are familiar with, which is body mass index, or BMI. So maybe, Noa, why don't you tell us what is BMI and what did you do differently here?
So BMI is a clinical measure of obesity. It's calculated from your height and weight. It's a cheap measure. It's well used in the clinic because it correlates with all-cause mortality and a number of chronic diseases such as diabetes and cardiovascular diseases. However, BMI is also a crude measure. It misclassifies people 30% of the times. So it's specifically important for the subset of people that have seemingly healthy BMI or normal BMI, but are actually metabolically unhealthy. And what is special about our measure that it is able to capture the heterogeneity of obesity and correctly classify people that have abnormal biological BMI or abnormal metabolic health, but normal BMI.
So basically, BMI is such an important factor for clinical measurement because it anticipates so many adverse conditions, but it also is an imperfect measurement. It doesn't capture the heterogeneity across people. So, Kengo, what did you all do to, I guess, better define BMI?
Yeah, recently, we scientists know blood has many information about human health, and so we generated a machine learning model from blood information to predict BMI, and we called it the biological BMI.
And the biological BMI agreed radically with BMI, or disagreed, or what did it tell you new?
So biological BMI correlates with actual BMI. Mm-hmm. So on average, the relationships that we expect to find are there. But in 30% of the cases, which is exactly the percentage of people misclassified, biological BMI did not agree with classically measured BMI. And we, in our study, we verified that the reason for this disagreement had biological reasons. So people that had normal BMI but abnormal biological BMI indeed had abnormal clinical measures such as triglycerides or insulin resistance. And vice versa, people that had abnormal classically measured BMI but normal biological BMI had better health compared to their to other members that had abnormal BMI that agreed with the classical BMI.
So in other words, for some 30% of the people that are not captured correctly by BMI, they may have an elevated risk of diabetes or cardiac disease that would not be perceived in a normal clinical measurement.
Yes.
And so Kengo, do you imagine that this biological BMI becomes a clinical tool, a replacement for BMI?
Yeah, in this study, we analyzed data from a wellness program. In this program, each participant received personalized lifestyle coaching, such as diet and exercise. And previous reports showed the program was successful. I mean, the participants became healthy in general. So we investigated the change of biological BMI in this study, and we found that biological BMI decreased more or faster than traditional BMI. So importantly, this is the case even for the person who did not decrease traditional BMI itself. Please imagine the situation. You want to improve your metabolic health, and you started to eat healthy food and exercise, and you are checking the body weight every day. Under that situation, if you can see the body weight decrease, then you may lose your motivation to keep healthy lifestyle. However, based on our study, if you monitor biological BMI, you may recognize that your health is actually improved. So like this example situation, our study suggests biological BMI is helpful for many situations.
So the biological BMI not only provides an effective piece of information that patients can use as feedback, but it also provides an effective piece of information that perhaps physicians can use as anticipating chronic disease or risk for chronic disease. So the study you did was pretty big, like 1,200 people studied over time. These individuals are by and large adults, so does that mean that you don't have much yet to say about juvenile BMI?
Right, our study focused on more than 1,200 adults not screened for any specific disease. So it was a fairly healthy cohort drawn from California and Washington populations. And it was individuals between the ages of 18 and 90. So indeed, we do not have data on biological BMI in children. However, a previous study that we have done, with our collaborators, we identified signatures in childhood in blood metabolites that predict metabolic syndrome in adults and as well as obesity. Because of the overlap with some of the markers we found in adults and in kids, we have good reasons to believe that blood metabolites would also be a good indicator of metabolic health in kids as well, but this would have to be confirmed in a future study.
Okay, and finally, in studies like the one you just did, where you have a large data cloud on the patients and you're trying to interpret lifestyle changes against standard clinical metrics, you're oftentimes seeing proteins or metabolites that correlate with improvements in these metrics. How far away are you from having causal relationships? Or what does your work do to help us begin thinking about causal relationships?
Yeah, it's a difficult point, and actually, our biological BMI model is constituted of multiple biomarkers, and it is some of them is just a correlate with obesity, but some of others may be causing factor for obesity. So I'm now optimistic for that, and because we narrow down the target biomarkers. And if those molecules are really causing factors, these molecules could be the actionable targets.
I see. Awesome. Well, Kengo and Noah, thank you so much. This has been very illuminating and very exciting. And congratulations on your research. Thank you.
Thank you.